As per usual, let's have a look at an example. Now, we're still dealing with a line integral in a plane with respect to an arc length. Here we have the z equals the f of x and y equals 1. So instead of this three-dimensional shape in three space, we now have this plane, flat plane, z equals 1. And it's on top of our curve in the xy plane of e to the power t plus 1 and e to the power t minus 1, and t is an element of this range from negative 1 to 1, the domain of negative 1 to 1. Now, think about any kind of shape. Once again, if I have a rectangle, and I have its height, and I have its width, and I want the area, that will be height times width. But what if the height is just 1? If the height is just 1, then the area, which is height times width, if height is just 1, area would equal the width. So if I made the height just 1, I would get the length of this. Now look what is happening here. My height everywhere above my curve is just 1. So if I get this line integral, what am I going to get? I'm going to get the line, the length of this curve in my xy plane. So that is one method of getting the length of a curve. The length of a curve in a two-dimensional space in the xy plane. So I don't have to change anything as far as my f and x and y is concerned. They've already been parametrized for me here, but it's just a constant 1, so that's not going to change. So if we look at the line integral over curve C of 1 ds, is what I'm talking here, is going to be, it's parametrized for me for negative 1 to 1. It's still going to remain 1 because it's just a constant. But now I need, there's another, let's just, also another method of doing this, where we had ds equals the square root of dx dt squared plus dy dt squared dt. I can also write this as same sort of method. I can write this as a vector, and my vector is going to be e to the power t plus 1 and e to the power t minus 1. I can now get the first derivative with respect to time of this. And what is that going to be? Well, very easy. That will be e to the power t, and that will also be e to the power t. If I now get the norm of this vector, is this going to be the square root of e to the power t squared, e to the power t squared. So that plus that, that'll be 2 e to the power t squared, which means that will just be square root of 2 times e to the power t. And so I'll build on to that. The 1 remains a 1. This becomes the square root of 2 times e to the power t and dt, because ds will equal this norm, this length, whatever that was, dt. So ds becomes that norm of the first derivative of that vector with respect to t, the dt. This is easy to solve. This will be square root of 2. This will remain e to the power t and going from negative 1 to 1. So we're going to have the square root of 2 e to the power 2 minus e to the power negative 1 or 1 over e. So this should be just the normal e to the power 1. So this will be the length of my curve going from a t value of negative 1 to 1, but it's also the area, the line integral, because it will give me the area of that shape. If I have a curved shape, imagine I have a piece of paper, let's have this piece of paper. If I have this piece of paper and the bottom of it makes some curve like this, and it is intersecting my plane. So for instance, this will just be a length of 1. If that's a length of 1, this whole area is just going to equal the length of my curve. Well, whether this is like this or a straight line, there's no difference in the length of a line that forms this bottom part of this piece of paper. So if I did this with a z value of 1 all over, I'm not only getting the area of this piece of paper, no matter in which way it lies, but I'm also getting the length of this arc at the bottom, the length of this curve in two spaces in the x, y plane.